this is John Cole with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. I'm here back at TD's about a month after I was here the last episode, which is the second episode in season two, TD's Grow For You, where he's growing over 10 pounds per plant in the holes that you see behind me. So the first thing I want to say is, if you guys haven't seen last year's grow, right, check the link down below for all whatever six episodes from last year. Last year I started about 2 weeks after he got his girls in the ground. This time it's 5 days after, plus I got two preceding episodes. You could see what he did to get to this point, because we're just showing you guys everything, right? Now the next thing I want to show you guys is, since I was here last, his girls have grown. The cool little transplant that I did last time that you guys saw on the episode has grown up, because that was one like literally he dug out of the ground, which is quite interesting. You'll learn why it's good and why it's bad. And that guy's going good, and it is a guy actually. And then you can see he got his grows in the ground. He's starting to pull them with his new string technique. He's filled this bed up with his soil mixture. And also he's planted his six plants in the ground. He has some auto flowers also that are currently flowering already. He also has some plants in pots that are gonna be gifted to friends, because when he started his seeds, he started more than he needed, because he wanted to select the very best plants to put in the ground. So he had the options of choosing the strongest, most hardy ones, and we're gonna go over and you're gonna learn why he chose the ones to put in the ground that he did. You're also gonna learn in this episode how he waters his girls. You're also gonna learn in this episode about the soil mix that he used. But more importantly, the most important thing in this episode is you will learn how to sex a male or female plant, and you want to get rid of your male plants. They're going to pollinate other people's plants, and they're not going to do nothing for nobody, so you definitely want to get rid of them. And that's one thing that TD is quite passionate about, all right? So anyways, let's get into this episode. I think first we're going to go ahead and hand cam it around the yard and show you guys what girls he's got in the ground and why. So the first thing I want to show you guys is just the overview. You can see he's got his whole place wood chipped. He brought in 15 yards of wood chips, so he has a nice clean grow, right? It's also going to moderate the moisture level with all the wood chips and just keep things nice and clean, so there's like no pests hiding and all this kind of stuff. He also has his new bed that I worked on, helped him fill up, totally filled up with the soil mix, and the girls planted out. So let's go ahead and walk around and share with you guys what he actually got into the ground this season. All right, first girl TD planted this season is the vanilla cream pine. I like that he's tagged them, and you can see the girl right here, he's starting to pull back already. So TD, what's up with the vanilla cream? Why did you plant this girl?
Vanilla cream pie is the one we're going to do the contest with this year. We got her in this hole, the little 6 foot hole, and then the 9 foot six hole has another one just like her in there. And she's from Humboldt Seed Company. She's one of the ones that we chose when all hell broke loose. She's 70% indica. Her taste is supposed to be like vanilla pastries, Boston cream pie, sweet fuel, they say. I don't know what they mean by sweet fuel, but that's a different taste. She's 23 to 25% THC. She takes 9 to 10 weeks for flowering. And she has a very, very upright growing habit, they say. So I'm having a hard time tying her down. You can tell I've already been through here this morning. She's already pointed up again.
Oh, wow.
She's not down. She's up. So they've been tough, but I think we can do it. They're not like the Skywalker we talked about years ago, how Skywalker OG was brittle. She's not brittle. She's just, she has an upright pattern.
Need to break her in.
What's that?
You need to break her in.
Yep, got to show her what the rules are.
All right, next one TD's got here is the new.
Okay, the new is actually from Humboldt Seed Organization. It's not actually from Humboldt Seed. They're two different Humboldt Seeds like we were talking. I guess they both still are into the breeding seeds. But this is Girl Scout Cookies and Larry OG mixed. And it's mostly indica. It's 9 to 10 weeks for flowering itself. It's that means it's, when they say 9 to 10 weeks, they're usually into like October. If they're 7 to 8 weeks, you can usually get them in like by into September. And she's 20 to 28%, and she's sweet, gassy, and hints of cinnamon. cookies, actually. It's supposed to taste kind of like cinnamon cookies. So she's, and she's the one that's supposed to get 14 foot tall. Now, I'm not gonna put no bets on that because the vanilla cream pie has already outgrown her. She's already on the move, but she does have one hell of a stalk already. That's the size of those big lead pencils that you used to get, if not bigger. She has the biggest stalk out here. That's why I chose her. She is, there's other gnus that are bigger and more filled in than her and taller and stuff, but she has more of a base, and I like to look at the structure of the plant. Plus, she already has 11 leaf pattern going on.
Next, we got the white runts. So it's just like a runt.
Okay. Yeah, so we got lucky. I have a friend that I get when I buy my seeds. He asked me to get him some. He doesn't always go with all the seeds that I want to grow because he's not into that. He's just some of the ones that I grow he wants. And he actually had some of the white runts and he had the glookies. And so I traded him some pineapple muffin and fire OG, and I got a white runts and a glookies. And the white runts is Skittles and gelato mixed. So those are both sweet. Skittles is a sweet flavor. Gelato is a sweet flavor. It's a hybrid. It's slightly on the indica side, even though it's a hybrid. And it's by Anisia Seeds. And it also is 7 to 9 weeks. And its flavor is pineapple, berry, and papayas tasting.
Any thoughts about this and how it's growing so far?
Okay, first of all, he gave it to me as his runt, and it's already doubled. So when he comes back, I can't wait to show him because I'm gonna be like, yeah, look at your runt now.
Next, we got the glookies. So tell me about the glookies, TD.
Glookies is another one that I was traded for that I really wanted to grow this year that we talked about because I was gonna grow some of the Barney's things. I actually got a Skittles from him too, a Gorilla Skittles, but I elected to do the glookies rather than the Skittles because I like the, it says it's got an amazing taste. It's you gotta try it to believe it. So that's one of the reasons. It's by Barney's. It's Gorilla Glue and Thin Mint Girl Scout Cookies mixed. It's 20 to 25% THC. It's again 7 to 9 weeks of flowering time. It's a mostly indica. It's supposed to taste like kind of like a sour diesel, a key lime, or like a walnut, more like an English walnut. So it has more of a kind of an earthy taste.
All right, cool. And then this is your standard 6 foot pot, in-ground pot, last episode for how he builds these guys. And then if you look around the edge, he's got all this white powder. This white powder is a diatomaceous earth to help keep the bugs from going in the beds. And it's doing a pretty good job, although the bugs currently can still climb up his little irrigation pipe and get into bed. So we talked about that and how he's gonna fix that probably next trip. He'll have that dealt with. So we got two more girls to talk about. All right, next girl we got, TD, is the stupid fruits.
Yep, stupid fruits.
So tell me about the stupid fruits.
It was made for a band, Slightly Stupid. And I actually listened to some of their music the other day. I wanted to know, you know, who it was made for and, you know, just a little information about them. And they actually play reggae music. It's really cool. I myself really am a fan of reggae. I like Bob Marley and stuff. I like that kind of music. But it's called Stupid Fruits. It's now this is my only one out here that has more sativa than indica. It's 80% sativa. Now, y'all know that sativa is more of an uppity high. It keeps you going all day and stuff. A lot of people don't believe that with pot, but it is true. The indicas are more of the, I would say a downer is how I would say it, more of a couch potato thing. These are more like you could work all day on them. But she's only 20% indica. She tastes like tropical fruit, strawberry, mango. She's an 8 to 9 weeks flowering, and she's from Humboldt Seed too. Okay, these vanilla cream pies and the stupid fruits is from Humboldt Seeds. The other one's from, the new is from Humboldt Seeds Organization. There's two different companies, just so you know. They're all three Humboldt Seeds, but two different companies.
All right, so the last one he's got is the vanilla cream pie, but this is in the monster 9 foot diameter in-ground pot that I helped build last trip. Once again, link down below to the video where we put this together so you could see. And he already talked about the heritage and vanilla cream pie genetics.
So if you look at this plant and you look at the very first one that we started with,
The first one has more structure, has more plantation going on. This one I put over here because it's behind. So if we're going to really do a contest, let's really do a contest.
One's behind, so it's going to have to catch up. Plus, the other one, but it's got a bigger place to catch up at.
Exactly. We're going to find out.
Cool. And then you got these auto flowers you're kind of playing with. We're not going to go into autos on this series. Maybe next year.
Probably don't want it with me. I don't look like I'm that good at it.
Yeah, he's still working on his auto techniques there. All right. So let's talk about next TD. How you selected the girls that you actually planted that you'll be growing out this season. Because I see you got a lot more girls in pots that you didn't plant out.
For instance, like this is one of the stupid fruits right here. And I like it a lot, but it's piled in here. It's like stacked in here like sardines. So I'm not really into these real short node stretches right here. I look for a plant that stretches a little bit more node. This is a stupid fruit right beside it, but it's got more stretch between the nodes.
So like more space.
More space, more air for us around here, so the humidity and stuff. Plus, I look at the bases. Like the Fire OGs, I didn't go with the Fire OGs.
They're too damn skinny, right?
Yeah, they look more sativa than anything. And their structure is just bony. I mean, I even have a nice one right there, and it's still a bony structure. It's not as filled out as, like, for instance, this was the first plant that we saved, the one that we saved that everybody else lost.
That one's pretty solid. Why don't you plant this girl on the ground?
Because it's Gorilla Skittles, and it takes to like almost the end of October. And I didn't want to wait that long, and we already have the new out here, and that takes to the end of October too. And so we could be wet by then. And so why waste our time just playing around again? Go from not getting pollinated to getting wet? That would make no sense. So I just didn't want to get, I like to stay towards the end of September, the beginning of October with the harvest. And most of these will do that. The pineapple muffin that I didn't grow, that's harvested in the middle of September. Now, I really wanted to grow it, but I wanted to really do the contest with the vanilla cream pies because I know that they're a relatively large plant. And I didn't want to do it with the news because it's like I said, we're wasting time. We're at the end of November. Who knows if we're going to even be able to do it at the end of November with the way the weather is. But the structure of the plant really means a lot to me. Like, for instance, I would take, these are both the same vanilla cream pies, and I would take this one over this one because its structural on this side is thinner than this one on this side. They're not uniform. This plant's really uniform. I look for uniformity, good bases. It's got great structure. It's proud. It's just, they're both about probably just as proud, but it's very proud plant. It's got a lot of new life growing at one time right here. About real light green. It's just brand new growth. It's a really good structured plant. I would probably pick that one too. I picked the other one though because I want to really do this contest between the vanilla cream pies.
I guess next let's go ahead and sex your plants because that's something real important. All your girls came out females except for two of the random ones that were seedlings that just came up in your yard.
Our volunteers.
The volunteers, yeah, the seedling volunteers.
We had four volunteers, and in the one pot where you planted, the one was called Monster Prophet, where it was that heavyweight. It was from Heavyweight last year. And out of the three seeds that popped, two were boys. That wasn't very good odds. That's like, you might not want to grow those. Not because it's just a waste of soil-wise and stuff. Water and all that. You know, if you're growing more boys than you are girls, you're wasting your soil, your time, and all that. That's why I stick with the feminized seeds. Is because if you have the feminized seeds, you know that they're guaranteed all girls. You just got to keep them alive. So, I mean, how much harder could that be? But that's why I did save those three seeds, is I wanted to see how good our boy was, if he was a hybrid, what's going on. I have no clue what bred us last year. You know, I think I have the corporal in my sights again, though. I got another guy up the street I got to go talk to this year. I found 13 little planters in his backyard, so...
So now we're going to show you guys how to sex your plants. Very important. TD wants you to learn this. Watch this and stop it and reverse it and watch it a couple times if you need to.
That's a nut right there.
All right. What are we looking at, TD?
Right there is where it looks like a roundish ball by the stem of the main stalk right here. And it's growing up right here. It's like a mainish ball, right? It's on both sides. There's another one over here. I don't know if you'll quite get that one in there.
Yeah, see it.
Okay, well... those are balls. This is a boy.
That's a boy. So you're going to destroy this plant because you don't want to grow it out. It's good for nothing.
Unless you're going to breed plants, so you want to get it secluded by itself, often like your own little greenhouse where you're not going to vent it downwind from your garden and stuff.
But if you're growing for flower, and what I encourage you guys to do is take this and just blend it up into a smoothie or juice it up and get that into you and show the male who's boss. All right, let's look at a girl. So what, this is the girl now. What's the main difference on the girl, TD?
Okay, look at the big difference here. Look how much taller her vagina would be, or whatever you want to call it, her sex organ. Look how much taller her sex organ is than the boy's. The boy was more towards the stalk down here and more round, like a basketball with kind of like a whoomp, whoomp, whoomp on top. This has a couple hairs coming out both sides.
So we got a couple little white hairs, right?
Transluent hairs, right?
So
here.
Like the boys will never have those little white hairs. They look like,
right,
actually,
there.
You know what they look like, TD? They look like your little white hairs coming up. If your girl's got little white hairs like TD's hair, then it's a girl, and that's a good thing, right?
So this is a lady right here, and she's got good growth patterns going on. She's got like nice green everywhere.
So you got to look at only the top growth, because we're looking at the top growth, or can you look at anywhere on the any little
like
joint?
Like I said, you have to get up there on the fourth and fifth nodes before they actually start to show. And other people, like lots of people will grow regular seeds, and what they'll do is they'll take these plants when they get about four nodes high, period, and they'll take them into darkness for like, I think they only give them like 8 hours or 5 hours of light, 6 hours of light or whatever. And they'll turn them into darkness so they will pre-flower for you. And they can that way they can tell if they're boys or girls. I don't suggest that. I suggest let them grow up. I mean, they make it in these 5 gallon pots. What's the hurry? And you get to do it. And we're only, this is May the 1st. And they're still already this big and they're ready to go in. So there's no reason to rush the thing and stress it. You don't want to stress the plant to see what its heritage is, if it's a male or female.
So this is the male. TD's assured me it's the male, so we're just going to take him. Look at this. We made an L out of him. Now we're just going to...
See how strong they are?
Wow, man, this thing is like... This is hemp, dude, hemp fiber. I can't even... Trying to... Finally, man. Got that, and then I'm gonna eat them. Eat your cannabis, guys. This is good stuff.
Stinks too.
Yeah, it's got some good smell. Yeah, and when they're younger, they're more, the leaves are more tender. Best time to eat them. So yeah, eat your males. Don't let them grow out.
Look at that thing.
It's good.
Now TD is gonna share his specific watering technique with you. First thing, most important thing, you guys can see he's got a spigot right here. The hose comes out. Most important thing, man, you guys got to get a water filter to water your plants so you don't kill the soil microbes with the chlorinated water if you're on city water. TD is using the Boogie Brew Plus filter, and actually that's a filter I use at my house. So he waters two ways. Number one, he's got a drip system coming on, and you can see it's just basically a bubbler. So he's got these bubblers coming out just around the ring, just to kind of get the water in there at different spots. But then, in addition to the bubblers, he's also got the watering wand that helps aerate the water more, add some oxygen to it as he waters. So TD, what's your watering technique? Why aren't you watering right at the base of the plant, man? Why are you watering out so far?
I want the roots to stretch out here. So I'll get up to this little mound that I built, but I won't go in there farther because there's no need. That plant's already out to this level right here, pretty much with its roots. When I planted it, it was pretty close to there. So within 6 days, I know its roots are pretty much almost got here. And this water will leach into there anyways. What we're going to do is flood this around this little circle here.
So around, you're not watering in the circle, you're watering around the circle to make the roots come out for the water so you can have a good root system.
Now when I first transplant these, I dig my hole, I take my pot, I mark out to where it's nice and even in here. It's not, you know, over to, I take my tape measure and I measure it out. And then I take the pot, after I have it, and I mark it with the pot itself. I just do a little circle, and then I dig it about 2 inches extra around each side. So when I sprinkle my pure protein in there, but before I sprinkle the pure protein in there, after I have the hole dug, I fill that hole all the way up with water twice.
to make sure that it's really, really wet in there. Then I sprinkle my protein in there, and then I plant my plant, and then I water it in one more time after I've kind of lightly pushed around the edges and set it. I like get it lightly pressed in and water it in one more time, and that's when I do actually water on the inside.
So the first planting only.
First couple times, yes.
First couple times.
And after that, I just start moving it to the outside because the soil's already been took care of all year, so it's already moist throughout all the soil anyways.
And you're flooding it pretty good. I mean,
I'll get it flooded. It'll fill up.
And that's why you got the plastic on the outside to kind of hold the water so it don't just all go away.
I'd be losing so much water right now. All this water, I'm on the outside edge trying to, you see the pot kind of leans that way. You got to, when you water these things.
Now the pot leans that way, so you're watering there because it'll just kind of migrate over.
Right. Shit flows downhill. So yep, we'll get it all watered in. This takes about 15 to 16 minutes per plant.
Wow, so you're out here, how often do you water it?
Right now I'm already up to every third day.
And then over the season, how will that change?
When they get towards flower, I'll water probably every other day. It all depends on the heat, too.
15 minutes per day each plant?
Yep.
That's a lot of work, man. It's like over an hour and a half. Six plants.
Once they pay off, it's worth it. If they get big, like I like them.
I wouldn't spend that much time with my plants.
They don't talk bad.
Well, not just 15 minutes of watering, I would get too bored. I would set up some kind of irrigation, man. Could somebody set up some irrigation? Why don't you use irrigation instead of, like, you know, hand watering, man?
Because I still have to come out here and do the valves for each one of them. I'd have to do the whole system. It's my time of kind of like making sure.
Oh, you're checking them too at the same time.
If I need to tie down more, like I'm really stoked about that's 11 leaf pattern.
Be clipping some off. You're like,
look at it. Count all those leaves on there. That's 11 leaves.
So what does that mean when you got 11 leaves
She's
on there?
Really happy. She. There's no stress with this plant. There's nothing going on. There's like three of them in this thing already have 11 leaf patterns.
So your growing practices, and you're just like taking really good care of these girls.
Yeah, they're really happy this year already. They've only been in like 6 days in here. She needed the light right there anyways, you see that?
Yep, open it up. and then if you want to check last year's episode, you could see how he pulls them, opens them up out there so that he gets the maximum amount of sunlight, so for faster growth.
Yeah, and then everything that you see inside there right now will all be gone by the time we get it out here, because anything inside that cage is cut out. But not until the proper time. Right now, it's still just growing. When we get it out to here, that'll all be gone before we put our first netting on, because you don't want to be trying to clean stuff up in the inside.
You need the airflow.
Yeah, exactly.
All right, wanted to give you guys an update. TD's literally been watering for like 15 minutes here. And you can see, like, literally, he's got like a moat. Like, it's literally a moat. Like, down here, you can see, like, it's all the water just moving. It's like a little lake right around the edge, but if you look, right, that's risen up in the middle. He don't water right in the middle. He's just watering around the moat, and this is why he waters deep. This is deep watering, guys, and plus he's got that plastic on there, so you guys can see it holds the water, doesn't leak out. So he's really kind of keeping the soil moist, which will be good for the beneficial microbes in the soil. Also cause the plant to like, oh, I gotta move to where the water is. It won't, the roots will grow really wide out to the edges. And he's got the bubblers, you know, just kind of like, supplementary water, but his main water is coming through his water wand that he likes so much. Cause it aerates the water as he's watering.
And when you're done, don't leave your hose on the pot, another ladder for the bugs.
Last part of this episode, we're going to share with you guys the soil mix TD uses. Everybody has always asked, what's the soil mix? And while, yes, soil is super critical, what also is super critical is everything else TD does. It's not just the soil mix, guys. And I know a lot of people want to just focus on getting the best soil, right? You can fudge your soil, but you got to get all the other stuff right, too. You know, using the techniques, the watering techniques, picking the right plants to put in the ground, picking the right genetics from the get-go, all the things, spending time with your plants. doing the diatomaceous earth. And before we go on, I want to talk about the, this is the seed starting mix. He just uses Miracle-Gro seed starting potting mix to start his girls off with, because I didn't show that last time. And he's got all the bags of stuff that he used to build his soil. So, TD, what's your overall soil mix that you like adding?
First thing I did, though, is I came out and put in our nematodes.
Now you put the Nemaseq beneficial nematodes. Now why'd you use a beneficial nematode?
To get rid of some bugs, and because we had some roly polies and stuff. And what I found out is, remember how last time you asked me about the coffee grounds and why I use them? Well, I looked into it farther since you asked me that question, and it deters slugs away. So I deterred the slugs by putting it on the ring of it. And then if you take a cup of coffee, a good cup of strong cup of coffee, and then dilute it with one cup of water, and you spray the slugs, you'll kill them. So these are supposed to help me get rid of bugs. They're supposed to be real beneficial for the soil. But once they've done their job, supposedly, they eat and move on. They don't stick around. So like if there's nothing for them to eat, they won't be here much longer.
Cool, now you got all these, you saved all the bags for me, so that's good.
Okay, we started off with the boogie base.
So you got the boogie base. We'll have Josh in a minute explaining what's in the boogie base. So you just got like bulk boogie base.
Yeah, I got the base in the back of my truck, actually.
Came in that bag.
Yeah, in this bag right here, the base came in the back of my truck.
And what percentage of base did you use overall?
Okay, when I first start with the base, what I do is I fill it up about halfway.
About halfway in the wheelbarrow.
Yep, and then I take, these are full of...
mixed, it's a mixed in there, yep. In that bag?
This was solid Caliwana worm castings.
Caliwana worm castings.
And then it was the humus and the biochar.
The boogie humus and the biochar.
So I take a quarter bag of this of each one.
A quarter bag of each of those into the wheelbarrow.
All three of those, and then I mix them all up. And then after I mix them up, I take one full bag, and why I'm using the Fox Farm is for my perlite.
The ocean forest.
Yeah. Not just for the perlite itself too, because it does have some beneficial products in there for us from the sea and stuff.
And then how much of this do you use?
3/4 of a bag.
3/4 of a bag.
Yep. And then I use about a quarter bag of pebbles with that. I mix these two up.
Pebbles.
Yep.
The Hydroton pebbles. In this case, you got some different ones because they didn't have the Hydroton.
Yes.
You got the Grow clay pebbles.
And I use these to do the Hydroton. That's what I like. And then this is my mix, and I mix all this up. And then I dump it in there until I get to where I'm only going to have, which makes it 4 wheelbarrows to fill the big pot.
Top it up.
Yeah, the little pot's only 2 wheelbarrows. The big one's 4.
Top it up every year.
Because I do the lasagna technique for the amendments.
I see.
And so the fish, the dust, and all that.
So once you fill this up in the pots, then you put you do the lasagna.
I kind of water it in first a little bit.
You water this stuff, the mixture you just
made
in.
Yeah, kind of settle it a little bit. You know, I don't go crazy like we did over there and water, just to kind of settle everybody down. And then I come back and I sprinkled my, I chopped up.
Your fish.
Yeah,
herring. The herring, fish.
I grinded
like whole fish ground up.
This pot got 12 pounds.
12 pounds of herring in there.
Yeah, and you know what? Herring, another good thing about herring, it gets rid of bugs too. The oils, I guess a lot of bugs don't like fish oils. It does not just herring oil, it's fish oil.
I don't like fish oil, it stinks.
Exactly. So the herring goes in there first, and then I throw down the neem seed.
So neem seed meal.
Yep.
You sprinkle this stuff down in there, or what? How much?
I coat the whole top like we're making lasagna, you know, and I make sure it's all covered, you know,
half inch.
It's more like a 16th. Inch.
Oh, 16, just very light,
eighth,
very light.
Eighth. Yeah.
Eighth inch.
And then the crab meal's next.
And the crab meal, that's definitely good. Going to build some fungal.
Yep.
Crab meal. This is the down to earth brand.
So I do the same thing, sprinkle it on there. Maybe a little bit thicker with this.
A little bit
thicker. It's a little bit more to break down, you know, it doesn't break down quite as fast as that neem meal.
Yep.
And then the kelp.
Yep, got the kelp meal, Acadian kelp.
I like to use all slow release products like this. I don't like to use bottle products, since it seems to me to work out better.
Yeah, I mean, this will be benefit your soil over the long period of time instead of a fast, hard hit grow, you know, like the pure protein's more fast, hard hitting. This is going to feed your soil so that you get a good sustained release. And better, your plants to be stronger over time. So
yes.
It makes sense.
And then I put in really thick.
azomite. So this is the rock dust. This is what I advocate for vegetable gardeners and cannabis growers. If you're growing anything,
I put that in almost like a half inch thick.
Half inch. Yeah, this is some good stuff.
I really go at it. It's all your calciums and all kinds of
silica. Yeah, all kinds of different traits. It's A to Z of minerals. Azomite is one brand of rock dust. Actually, this is technically a clay dust, but these are hard to find. Maybe better grow stores might have them. You could look at azomite.com. You could find a dealer near you. I get mine at actually they're cheaper to buy at like a livestock feed place than like a soil store. They charge cheaper prices. All right, so then you layer on this, and then what happens, TD?
Then I come back and I mix up the same soil again.
Your same soil that you that you fill the beds with, and you top it over the top.
Four more mixes, top it off, and just kind of spread it nice and lightly with the back of the rake, and then water it in. And I like to do this a month before I plant my plants.
Alright, so you're kind of like getting it broken down and getting the soil microbes in there, so it's not just newly fresh, and then you plant immediately.
Correct, yes.
That's smart, man.
Yes, and it's had probably, this year I've gathered probably over 1,000 gallons of milk. Last week they turned out 50 cows, so I didn't get to get some. But they say, I was reading more.
And wait. Now, what do you do with the milk for those of you guys that didn't see last year's, because we talked about it then, but you water the ground with the milk, with cow milk.
I actually take, and I get 100 gallons at a time, and I have a...
Is it sour milk or fresh milk?
Fresh.
Fresh milk.
That day. I mean, it's got the cream on top.
Now, people are crazy, like, I mean, you get a good deal on that, but
that's the thing.
Would it be good for somebody to buy that much milk in jugs to like feed their girls and feed their soil milk if they didn't get it for
what
free?
I read, if you do it correctly, you should only have to do it once every month anyways, because they said that you don't want to overfeed the microbes and get them used to eating. So I didn't want to, I do it every 2 weeks. I just... get them used to it.
So if they can't afford or want to buy all that much milk, what else would you recommend instead? Maybe some
boogie tea.
Compost tea, or you could get some actually
and if boogie brew runs out, make your own workhorse.
You can make some like you can get the milk powder. They got the freeze dried milk powder. You could like mix with water, and then maybe that's kind of a substitute. All right, and then when you plant, you mound them up, and then you just plant the girls in there. Any special technique when you plant the girls in the mound in the middle?
Remember, I dug it out. I filled up the hole with water. Then I sprinkled the pure protein around the edges, and I have a scooper. I don't do it like John did with the bag. He was just demonstrating. But I take the scooper and I lightly coat the whole edges and the bottom with that pure protein. And then I plant my plant, lightly pack it in, then water it in there 2 to 3 times in right at the base. And then once they've been in there a good week, I always go to the outside. That's why the cage is on now. Once I feel like I'm tying them down, they're fine. They're good to go. I've never had a problem yet, and probably never will, because if you think about it, you're only 2 inches away.
Yeah.
So
it's they're not, right there.
Yeah, they're right there.
And the water will capillate in there and whatnot, so don't feel like, oh, I got a water right at the base. Like, they're going to find
pretty much
water.
Why I flood anyways.
Exactly.
And when I planted those plants, like I told you, I chopped off the first 2 sets of branches. And then when I planted them, that's why they're so low. They were higher like these other ones.
You buried them.
I deepened them because I get bigger roots that way. Where I cut the branches off, I'll get a big set of roots again. Nice, good formity on both sides too. You'll see it by the time they're done, like last year.
Dig the roots up again. Yeah, so you want to see what the roots look like, look at last year's episode, final episode, where he shows the harvest and like how big and massive the roots were. It's insane.
Yeah, that was a fun year.
Cool, TD.
We'll have another good one.
Any other words of wisdom you want to share with my viewers before we get Josh on talking about the boogie base, which is, you know, the majority of what you're using?
No, I think we pretty much covered it. We did a lot today. We showed them the watering, how I pick my plants. I appreciate the love you guys shared last time when I barked out all my crying about the jerks out there, but it was cool. You got a lot of good viewers, John.
Right on, man. All right. Thanks, TD. Let's go ahead and get Josh and talk about what's in the boogie base that you guys can't buy. Yeah. When special people like TD and me get it. Actually, I get it from my vegetable garden. So the last part of this episode, we got Josh from Boogie Brew, and it's actually the Boogie Brew boogie base is what TD uses as literally half of his mix that he mixes up all the other amendments that you guys saw. But TD didn't know exactly all the proportions of what's in the boogie base. So we got Josh from Boogie Brew. So Josh, if somebody wants to just buy your boogie base, can they buy it from you? Yeah, we sell Boogie Base. Like locally, you don't ship it, right?
No, we ship it. It's part B of Boogie Brew Tea, and it's available by itself, you know, for people that don't feel the need always for the Boogie Boost ingredients or even want to use just the base instead of as a tea, as TD just did, as a valuable soil prep or as a top dress. I mean, the hesitation you see in me about whether it's available, yes, it is a Boogie product. Yes, we sell it. No, don't buy it from my website. Make your own bloody base.
Yeah, because I mean, you're going to go broke trying to buy as much from the website to that TDUs to fill and stuff, because Josh tells us to buy a little bag, you know, and you can't, like, yeah, so Josh, because it's not like super exquisite, crazy ingredients, right, man. You can get a lot of these ingredients locally, but of course, Josh gets the best quality ingredients to put in. So Josh, go over what's in the Boogie Base by percentages, so people
know.
Well,
you can go back and look at the original open source compost tea video.
Updated, because you've updated and kind of made it better.
We have, we've massaged it, and actually there's some surprises in store with Boogie Brew. There's gonna be a Caliwana Boogie Brew, basically. We're launching a Caliwana version. So anyway.
In your Boogie Base, what's the percentages and what's in there for somebody who wants to make their own?
30% worm castings, 30% composted wood chip compost, composted wood chip hummus, 15 to 20% thereabouts activated biochar, 5% or thereabouts frass, insect frass.
The black frass.
Well, in our case, yeah, the black soldier fly frass.
Not all frass created equal, not all worm casting created equal, not all hummus is created equal either. So right, do the best you guys can.
Right, do whatever. You know, if there's an angle bait facility near you, you know, go fearlessly and get that as what would be a waste product to an angle bait worm farm that doesn't know better, the trillions of species that are in that leftover insect meal.
Or even like, yeah, if you have like live in LA, you can go to Rainbow Mealworms. I was just last weekend. They're out of frass, and basically they charge you $2 for a big bag. But
Glad they were out of frass.
Yeah, use your Boogie Black personally, but I like to mix both of them because honestly, that's the best thing to do.
We bought a lot of frass a couple of years ago, 2 years in a row, from the Canadian supplier Enterra, and they sell it as a feed too. By the way, it's great for chickens. We like it because that one's been thermophilically composted, so there's no danger of any leftover E. coli that can coexist with all the good species that might be in a more raw, final heat, you know what I mean?
And the black soldier flies have a more diverse diet, like food scraps, right?
They're the nature's greatest composting creature, and as such, they secrete the most natural antibiotic compounds. They're kind of like how fecal coliform transplants can be the only thing that will work in someone suffering from such a bad intestinal infection that no antibiotic can cure it, whereas the transplant from someone else's poop can. So the best nature transplant you can give your soil is, I believe, black soldier fly is.
But mix them up, of course, all the different frasses.
And so now we've still got a few percentage there with the azomite. In our case, we use the Cascade, but that's also a good rock dust. And then in our case, a bit of C90, but C90, treat it like a salt on food. Less is more, just a pinch, okay? But like I said, I want you making your own base. So here's a tip. Find free local wood chip, get a pile going, and then get, go to a micro brewery or someone, again, you know, find a beer club. It doesn't take much. Get a barrel of leftover beer hop yeast mash and soak that wood chip pile with the enzyme bath, John, from, you know, beer hop yeast mash, and let it heat up, you know, and compost, and feed it some nitrogen if you want, you know, some alfalfa and some green waste, and boom, you have like, the enzymes will be like a bath from the beer. They might not produce alcohol anymore for a beer, but my goodness, the carbon digesters will kick into overload, and you'll have hummus, you know, within a season. And this is much more important to me than selling you some Boogie Base on our website. And yeah, we do have
Well, now the postal service is, you know, now they've changed everything. It's costing me more to ship castings and Boogie Base, but we used to do the board game boxes. I believe it's because of you and Boogie Brew's board game box shipping that now they no longer make them available.
Try other people.
Oh my God, it's enough to piss off the pup. Now I have to ship them in two mediums, but none of these are ship. The hesitation you see in me,
yeah,
and it's not my fear of success, it's that I
it's
don't
just view, not sustainable.
It's not sustainable. It's not part of Boogie Brew's vision
ethos.
For what, right, ethos, thank you, for what should be a shippable product. And like you've heard me say now in a couple of recent videos, you know, it's time maybe instead of selling you even the best castings, you know, OGS dropship, or, you know, our new Caliwana castings.
Make your own.
A boogie bin to make your own.
And a boogie chow to feed your worm castings the best feeds, because that's the other thing. I mean, I teach you guys how to do all these things. If you guys want to make your own castings, check out the video down below. It's the OGS video.
Just buy the book, but Worms Eat My Garbage.
No, because he has very special feeds in there to feed the worms so that he gets better stuff, you know. And then check out the interview I did with the Worm Gold Plus guy, you know, feeding... you know, chitin-rich foods and cardboard, so you have the chitin degraders in there. You know, success leaves clues, and you want to model this because most worm farms are not adding these unique ingredients. If you want to have good wood chip hummus, right, I would recommend watching the video I made up in Portland, Oregon, where I visited these people that just got truckloads of wood chips and let them degrade over years, and they got the best wood chip hummus that I've never seen for sale anywhere. You can make it yourself. Super simply and super easily, right?
I mean, we're spoiled. Like right now, the reincarnation of Sonoma compost is a much more sustainable, even much cleaner base ingredients going into it. West Marin compost in Nicosia. You need to visit out there one of these weekends.
Yeah.
And, just it's the cleanliness of the sourced waste compost, green waste and wood materials to begin with no plastics, right? In the food chain. Let me give you an example of how impure and how bad sourcing your own, you know, cheap local ag inputs has gotten is the Florida horse manure crisis that one of your viewers just recently educated me on. I think it's Carol. Thank you, Carol, out of Florida. I hope I remembered the right name. Like one of the most horse regions, Gainesville, Florida, with all these rich people and their amazing horse farms. Well, the hay now in the food chain has been sprayed with the stuff called Grazon, G-R-A-Z-O-N. What a cute name for a nasty aminoclopride. It reminds me of the neonicotinoid sounding kind of name. And it's an herbicide that's now sprayed on all the hay crops.
That
now,
goes through the horses.
That goes then... through the horse's intestinal tract. Now people are getting this nice, cooked out, finished horse manure compost, and it is killing everything in their gardens.
That's why I encourage you guys, don't use animal manures, man, unless you make it yourself, you know the source.
I mean, it's so disheartening when you hear stories like that, because that's a wonderful free or semi-free local resource from people who feed their horses better than most humans probably eat, you know, except they don't. Somehow the chemotocracy has gotten in there and convinced, I think it was University of Florida. Oh, once you get a college involved, well then the science behind it must be that this stuff should be used for more productive hay.
All right, Josh, we're getting off track here. We got to finish up on this episode.
No, we're any not other... getting off track. We
Dude,
are on
We got
track.
To make a separate video for this, Josh.
Well, okay, maybe I'm getting off track, but I'm not. I'm on track with you because you're the future, his viewers. You're the only hope our society has. Not Boogie Brew selling you these base ingredients. We're talking compost tea wisdom, or even TD. He's part of it too, growing your food and medicine too, using the cheapest, cleanest, local resources that you can sniff out. Just like when he knows how to go out from the best day on a boat for crab, all right? He has that nose that sniffs out the it's a feel-based system. I don't mean to sound so vague, like lawyers love vagueness, gray area, you know, vague. I don't mean to sound vague, but we know so little anyway about what's really going on with the ground beneath our feet. And shame on us, and shame on our chemotocracy of a society that we've lost it. We really have, and the only place you can find clean soil anymore is in places like this, in TD's medical yard, with plastic-free, you know what I mean, with inputs that haven't been so tainted. I came on here to talk to you about why he uses boogie bass and what goes into boogie bass. Make your own bass. In every community, in every possible place, make your own bass.
Definitely.
And keep growing. You know? Yeah,
definitely.
Just keep growing.
I would concur with that. So, Josh, if somebody wants to buy, you know, some of the other products that TD uses, like the Caliwana castings or the pure protein that is shippable in small
very
quantities and
yeah.
actually quite a concentrated product, which I also really like a lot.
Mm-hmm.
How can they do that and get the special GYG hookup price?
Well, we got the GYG page. He won't let us put a link on our site. I hear these words in my sleep at night. Boogiebrew.net/GYG. Thank you, John, for introducing me to you old GYGers. I'm busting my ass more than ever. And I'm getting a little boogie burnt, you know? As enthusiastic as you hear me now, and I still love an audience more than ever. If you want to be a better farmer, remind me when to shut up. And thanks for all for listening. And I don't know how to clone a boogie Josh. So I'm limited, you know what I mean, in my capacity. But you are unlimited. This is a limitless movement. John's audience, and because of you, you know, he found us, and he happened to be this close, you know, to us, and we to him. To TD, and so that, you know, he got lucky finding, you know, getting the bro deal. I mean, if we were rich, we'd sponsor him with all the free boogie bass, and we'd make, you know, train loads of it. So yeah, boogiebrew.net/GYG. The Boogie Brew is a shippable product. The pure protein's a shippable product. You want to keep supporting Boogie Brew, watching me get more stressed, and, you know, at the end of the day, just owing more back taxes. That's fine. I'm happy to do it with you. And, you know, thank you for supporting my sexy little compost tea company and using these products. And, you know, it's fun to watch, mostly, to observe this as I sell through my little my pipeline, not yours. He doesn't profit a penny from anything he's ever helped us introduce to you all. And neither do we at the end of the day. But it's the emotional reward that we get to profit from more than ever. So I want to thank you for that.
So if you guys enjoyed this episode of TD's learning about how he's growing his cannabis, make sure you give this video a thumbs up and share it with somebody else. That helps out the YouTube algorithm, get this video out to more people. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new and upcoming episode that I come out every 5 to 7 days. You never know where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel, and you'll get notified as my next video comes out with TD. Make sure you also check my past episodes, links down below to all the videos I've made in the past with TD. I want you guys to get caught up if this is the first one you're watching, because I have, I don't know, like 7 episodes or 8 episodes now with TD, all sharing his wisdom on his specific method to his madness to get the crazy yields that he does. All right, so with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and until then, remember, keep on growing.